two of their facilitators and the co-creator of the program, being Allison Hill and Jhanelle Peters. Wanted to say thank you so very much to each and every one of you for holding space with us this evening as we have and hold intentional dialogue on allyship and what this means and how we can engage and activate this desire and intention of being in solidarity with folks and being authentic allies in our day to day. Next slide, please. So wanting to acknowledge a few things, and first of that is that regardless of where we are gathered geographically, that we are indeed gathered on Indigenous land. Wanting to acknowledge it as we have been sort of thrown in the deep end, in the subsumes of the waters of all things anti-racism, of this important work, acknowledging that we have been witnessing in real life for years the impacts of racism and colonialism on Indigenous peoples and community. Wanting to acknowledge that as we have been engaged in these conversations, not only in 2020, but for many years prior to, that we've actually been gifted with a pathway, with a list of actions and directives through Truth and Reconciliation calls to action. So wanting to invite us that as we engage in intentional thought and intentional practice in allyship, that we indeed revisit these calls to action and revisit the list of requests, the directives, the actions that we have been asked to engage in to build, to continue to build our relationships as well as engage in authentic reconciliation with Indigenous peoples. We are very much excited to be here in community. This is this moment where it's 6 p.m. in the evening. I want to ensure folks are comfortable. Grab your beverage of choice. Ensure that you're wearing your most comfortable attire at this time as we hold some space of intentional for discussion, but as well as just some soul searching and some healing. That's what this hour moment is to be. And so in preparation for the dialogue that we're going to engage in, next slide, please. Just going to ask for folks to be mindful of how we engage with one another. Let's take this word respect, define it for yourself, manifest it in your interactions, manifest it in your dialogue. As much as we have not had any issues to date, knock on all things wooden, also wanting to acknowledge though the reality of the Zoom platform and virtual platforms, please go to the next slide. Wanting to acknowledge that indeed if the organizers of the event are not able to regain control, if we lose control of the virtual platform, though I will be sending out a note to everyone indicating that we will have to reschedule the session. So just gonna ask for mindfulness in our dialogue with ourselves and one another, and inviting that we just hold this 1 hour space with some intentionality of respect and authenticity and sincerity. Please note a few components of this session as well, is that one, the session is being recorded. The recorded sessions are made available on ArcDo's website for future viewing. We are asking and inviting folks to please turn off all webcams at this time. The facilitators will be inviting engagement in various ways throughout the next little while that we have together. And you'll also note that automatically you may be seeing some subtitles popping up at the bottom of your screen. So note that this session is being live captioned. However, this is a feature that you do not wish to have active at this time. If you click the CC button at the bottom of the screen, it should be able to turn off the live transcription that's taking place. And so without much further ado, I'd like to invite, if we could go to the next slide, please. I'd like to introduce to you our facilitators for the time that we have together, which is Allison Hill, who's the creator and curator of the Hill Insider and the Restore Program, and you know, fabulous hairdresser and all things in between. So very excited to continue working and partnering with you, Allison. And the very thoughtful and thought-provoking facilitator of Jhanelle Peters. Again, thank you so very much for holding space with us today. And without much further ado, I now pass it to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jody. Thank you, everyone, for pulling up today. Before we get started, I want to discuss how we're going to engage today, we're going to use the chat box to do so. So if you are here, if you have some coffee or some tea or a drink or a bag of chips, I want to know in the chat. I want to know that you guys are here and with me. It is 6 o'clock. By 7 o'clock, we are going to be out of here. So just let me know if you're with me by sharing it in the chat. Okay, I'm seeing the hellos. I have coffee, I have tea. Hello, hi, Allison. Okay, perfect. This is how we're going to be talking to each other today. And I want to be really upfront about what mindfulness kind of means to me. This is not a class or a discussion that's meant to like give you the answers or to lead you in a certain direction. We are opening up the discussion because we want, oh, jalapeno chips. Yes, let's go. Okay. We want to hear from you. Where does your mind go when you're in incidences, when you have to think of solutions? What can we do to mindfully guide ourselves in the direction of progression? So today, my name is Allison Hill. I'm going to be leading this session along with Jhanelle Peters. We're going to get into it. We're probably going to say some pretty prickly things that might bring up feelings or things that you've been through. That's okay. You're in a safe space. Share it with us. We're going to help you decode some of that today. Our title today is Mindful Steps Towards Collectively Eliminating Racism. Jhanelle. All right, you're on mic. Are you in?
It was glitching for a second. What was that?
Okay, just making sure. Are you with me?
I'm here, and I hope all of you are here. Here are the goodies. We got dinner, so I think we're set. I think we're ready to go. Okay,
good to go. So get comfy, guys. This is informal. We're just going to get into it. We're going to get into it with some conversations today. Okay, so Natasha, I believe that you are helping me. Perfect. Okay, we're on to the next slide. Today, we will be discussing collectively the collective responsibility of eliminating racism. Too many words. Do you know why? Because we were born into this situation, okay? A lot of us now are realizing, because of all these discussions that are happening, how ingrained racism it really is in our culture. And I, you know, before we even get into it, I just want to say shout out to your generation. I am what would be considered kind of an older millennial. But one of the things that I noticed during a lot of the protesting that was happening over the past 3, 4, 5 months is that your generation was really leading the charge on changing the discussion and bringing to the front, like the things that our society has been sweeping under the rug for a very long time. So shout out to you if you guys were holding signs or marching around, drop kicking police, whatever it was you were doing out there, we appreciate you because your voice, your experiences are what's going to change the world. Our intention today is to lead you through a series of questions and prompts to create mindful steps towards eliminating racism. I really do feel like my words are caught in my mouth. Okay. So first, we would like to acknowledge that speaking up isn't easy, and quite frankly, it's not without consequence. As we lead you through these questions and prompts, we would love to hear from you through the text box. But if you don't feel comfortable sharing there, that's okay, it's not required. Here's a couple things that you can do. You can change your name if you'd like to. And when Jhanelle looks through the comments, she's not going to read out your names because we are recording and we want to make sure that you can share safely without feeling that you are in danger. Next slide, please. Okay. So the first thing that we're going to discuss here is a question that I want you to ask yourself throughout this process. Now, most of us, or most people, would not consider themselves out and out racist, right? Who does that anymore? But would you consider yourself anti-racist? So just give me some yes, some no, some I don't know what that means in the chat box. Would you consider yourself anti-racist? What is anti-racism? Anti-racism examines the power imbalance between racialized people and non-racialized people. These imbalances play out in the form of unearned privileges. So what's an anti-racist? An anti-racist is a person who opposes racism and promotes racial tolerance. Now, does that sound like you? Would you consider yourself someone who is anti-racist? Let's go to the next slide, please. Okay, so what are the topics we're going over here today? We are going to decode microaggressions. We're going to center the impacted, and we're going to activate our advantages. Now, Jhanelle, can you tell me from the chat, what was the feedback? Do people consider themselves mm-hmm. anti-racist?
We got a lot of, I'm working on it, right? A lot of, I'm trying, I'm learning, taking the right steps. And then a few more contexts in regards to, you know, it's not something I think about every day. So when I reflect on it, when you're actually putting this question to the group, it's, well, yeah, I need to sit and process that for a minute. I need to really think about, am I anti-racist? So yeah, it seems like it's something that we can definitely check back in after to ask and see if anybody has a better understanding of where they sit once they learn a little bit more of the difference.
Okay, awesome. Love to see it. Okay, next slide, please. So the first thing we're gonna get into is decoding microaggressions. Now, I'm sure everybody in the room knows what a microaggression is, but most of us know exactly what it is. But today we're gonna take a step further in understanding how it actually impacts our minds and our bodies, okay? So I want you to think of maybe an incident that you've been in before where you felt like you've experienced racism. And you've thought to yourself, what just happened here? Did I imagine that? Am I overreacting? Let me know in the chat box, have you experienced an incident where you felt like it was racism, but you walked away feeling like a little confused? You didn't really know where to place it. Okay. Got some yeses in here. Can I get the next slide? Okay, you might be a victim of what we would consider a microaggression. Are we getting any yeses, Jhanelle? What are people saying in the chat?
Getting a yes. Yeah, somebody's actually sharing, you know, their incident itself that happened. Okay. Yeah. So I was getting ready to speak to a group of 1,000 women, and the person introducing me called me exotic while reading my bio.
Okay. Okay. Perfect. Okay. Now, so a microaggression. What does a microaggression look like? So by definition, a microaggression is a comment or an action that negatively targets a marginalized group or people. A microaggression can be intentional, it can be accidental, but either way, no matter how it comes out, it is still a form of discrimination. And I would also like to pause here just to note the word or the part of this word that we refer to as micro. Okay, now, because micro sort of implies that your experiences are like a little smaller than you might have thought, or that the discrimination is not as real or as bad as you think. It kind of gives the opportunity for the aggression to hide a little bit, to be covert or be completely hidden. Microaggressions can cause us to doubt ourselves as to whether or not the thing even happened. But that moment of doubt, that feeling still sits in your body somewhere, right? But you don't know exactly what happened. It doesn't mean it didn't happen to you. So I'm using the term micro here lightly, because I do believe that the discussion around aggressions is an evolving one. And maybe in 3 years from now, we'll look back and say, why were we even saying micro? But today we're just going to use the term because that's what it's used as. Next point, please. Next slide, please. Okay. So we're going to look at the different type of microaggressions. We're going to start with the first here called a microassault. Microassault is an explicit racial aggression. It can be verbal, nonverbal, name calling, behavior, purposeful, discriminatory actions. Okay. Anybody here know what I'm saying? You can drop a yes, a no, a I'm confused in the box. So what does a microassault look like? So a microassault can look like somebody blatantly telling a racist joke and then say, I'm just kidding, guys. Everybody just calm down. It's just a joke. Okay, microassaults are the biggest. They're the most explicitly violent. They're the most obvious. They are deliberate, right? And they're usually coming from people who feel protected or feel like there's not going to be much.
Allison, I think you froze.
Allison, we're having a bit of audio issues there.
But behind the guys, my internet.
Yeah, you're cutting out a little bit.
Hiding behind social media or whatever. Am I back? There I am.
Yeah, that's a little bit better.
Is that better?
Yes.
Okay, lovely. So we're still on micro assault. But what I was saying is that most people are hiding behind the fact that they probably will not get caught and can do it without consequence. Next slide, please. So my first question to you, or one of my questions to you is, have you in the past year, month, experienced a microassault that you can think of? You can share it, or you can just say yes, or you can say no. And then Jhanelle, please let us know what's coming
in. We got all the time. Just waiting to see what else comes in. Not personally, we have a few yes. So one of the things that really stood out with the comments is a lot of people really enjoyed the examples of them to kind of give more context to the different types of microaggression. So I think that will definitely help resonate some more for those who may have witnessed it and maybe not even realized.
Okay. Okay, cool. So we have microassaults under our belt. Somebody buying a birth card. Thanks, sorry, monkey. Wow. Okay, let's move to our next slide about micro insults. Okay, so micro insults are a little bit more tricky to identify. They are a little bit more subtle in their acts, and they just convey straight up contempt and disrespect. Okay, they're subtle, they're spur of the moment, they're a little bit more backhanded, and it's hard to tell sometimes even if the perpetrator actually meant to be insulting. So what does an example of a micro insult look like? I used to hear this one all the time. You're really articulate for a Black girl. You're not as like, you know, you're not like the other, like, you're not like Black. You're like friendly, you know, those sort of things where it's like, they're trying to be nice, but you're actually very much insulting me and my entire race. That's what a micro insult might look like. Now, why are micro insults so infuriating? Because typically the person saying it is saying it with a smile. They actually think that they're complimenting you. Next slide, please. So my question here is, have you experienced a micro insult?
So we got a lot of the articulate, everybody saying that that's something that's come up for them as well. Just, you know, the assumption that based on the color of your skin that you must like basketball or a particular sport. Also that you are pretty for the type of person that you are, of being that person of color. Asking about certain types of food. So everybody's saying yes, like this is something that comes in very often.
Okay. Now, the thing about micro insults is that because they tend to come from people that we don't think are bad, maybe they're our friends or they're our family, that it's a little bit harder to call out because you don't want to make the situation uncomfortable. But these things still take a spot in your mind. They still take a spot in your body. And that's why over time, micro insults can really play on your mental and your physical health. Next slide, please. Okay, now a micro invalidation. What's a micro invalidation? This is when a person's comments invalidates or undermines the experiences of a certain group of people. Micro invalidations imply that your experiences of discrimination aren't real. Like you're just kind of over exaggerating. So an example of a micro invalidation might be someone saying, racism's not really a thing in Canada. I mean, look at how bad America is, right? Like Canadians, we're not racist. Or maybe it might sound like, I don't see color. You know, when you call out somebody for a microaggression and their response is, I can't be racist. I don't even see color. I wasn't raised that way. Or maybe they might say something like, all lives matter, not just Black lives, all lives matter. The term is problematic because it invalidates everybody else's experiences that differs from your own, right? So the fact is that no one is immune to seeing color. Nobody is immune to seeing race. These are all things that we carry with us, right? From the day we are born. The problem is that we need to start to invite mindfulness into acknowledging the way that these ideas are shaping how we treat each other. Can we get our next slide? So my question is, have you experienced a micro invalidation?
So we definitely have a few. Individuals really sharing the fact that, you know, one of the biggest challenges with experiencing any of these microaggressions, whether it's invalidation, assault, is that how do you counteract it? Like, do I go further into it if I say something? Am I going to be now labeled as aggressive by speaking up? And I think just like you touched on, Allison, it's one of those things that because it causes so much confusion when it enters, you hear it and you're like, wait a minute, did I really hear that correctly or is it just me? And then it's like, well, if I respond and it really was just me interpreting something, what if I'm responding and now become that aggressor, right? So it is a really difficult thing to navigate. And just as we are looking at the chat, yeah, everybody's saying yes. Again, like you said, Allison, the whole, this doesn't happen here in Canada. And I mean, the reality is we can go back to history of how some of it's ingrained in what we see around us. And it didn't come from nowhere. People aren't protesting in Canada just for the sake of it, right? So definitely stirring up some conversation.
Okay, so the next slide is how do we counteract experiencing all these microaggressions, right? Because, okay, I'm just gonna ask everybody and you can be as frank as you want to be here. When a microaggression happens to you, what is the first thing you actually want to do? Because I want to cuss bad words. Okay. It infuriates me. I don't really know where to put my feelings. Sometimes I can't tell, like, should I just speak up or should I not say anything? Is this experience going to make things worse for me? Like, how do you guys feel when these things happen to you? Okay, so this is what we're going to do in this exercise, because whether or not you get an opportunity to, let's say, speak out, that thing still sits on you. So right now, I want you to think of a moment where you might have experienced a micro-invalidation, insult, or aggression. And I want you to take a moment to categorize where that aggression sits for you. Once you've done that, I want you to decode what that message might have sent to you. Right? So when I hear things like, you're really articulate, wow, you speak so well, that sends a message to me that that person doesn't think that people that look like me or people that come from a place like me should be articulate. What's coming out of the chat, Jhanelle?
We're getting a lot of, when you asked where does it sit and what happens when they experience it the first time, everybody kind of in some way pauses. So whether it's confusion, whether it's freezing, whether it's having an uncomfortable, you know, feeling in your stomach or some type of disbelief, it's that whole questioning aspect. And like you said, that's what makes this really challenging, is because not only are you questioning what was said to you, but you're also questioning, well, what does that mean for me?
Okay. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Okay. We cannot change some of the circumstances that we're in, right? You go to school where you go to school. You take the subway where you take the subway. You live with your family where you live with your family. There's so many situations that we're in where we're going to experience microaggressions against us that we might not be able to completely change our circumstances. So the trick here is to notice the aggression, but not to absorb it. And how do we do that? By identifying how you feel and countering that negative message with a positive one, right? So for me, hearing that, you know, you're pretty smart for a Black girl, or you're very articulate. I know why I'm articulate, right? I can answer it by saying, I read a lot of books. I went to university. My parents made a lot of sacrifices to make sure that I can. I'm generally interested in education. So instead of letting that sit on you, and you, this exercise encourages you to actually answer, and not answer them, but answer what happens inside of your body. Jhanelle, can you think of something that maybe has happened to you within a microaggression? How do you answer your microaggressions?
I definitely feel like for me, similar to some people in the chat, it's when people are shocked of maybe a role or position that you might hold within your job or your career. And it's that, oh, that's you, this, you're that person. And I think for similar to what you said, it's knowing, yes, I am that person. I think it's taking it outside of the situation itself. And it might not always be in that moment the easiest to respond and counter that positive message for yourself. Maybe it's taking it away for a second and sitting with it and be like, what did that bring up? So for those of you that said, sits in my psyche, it sits in my stomach, I freeze. Why am I freezing? How would I want to respond to this? And kind of telling yourself, like Allison said, what is that positive message that you will bring the next time it comes up? Because you've now sat with it and know that I'm not just smart for a Black girl, right? I'm smart. Here's all the reasons why I'm smart. I'm not just in this role because of the color of my skin, or nor should you be surprised that I'm in a role of such, you know, nature. I think it's sitting with those and realizing, how do I want to respond to this the next time it comes around, so I don't freeze like many of you shared.
Mm-hmm. And I think it's also important to find yourself. There's two fights that are going on when you experience this, right? There's a fight against the person who has committed the aggression, but there's also what's happening in your body.
Or losing you again there, Allison.
Out against somebody who's committed something to you. But you are, sorry, you can hear me?
You were a little bit choppy there, a little internet.
Oh, okay.
We got you now. We got you.
Am
now.
I back?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for letting me know. Okay, so what I was saying is that there's two different fights that are going on when you experience a microaggression. There is the fight between yourself and the person that's committed the aggression. And there's also the fight between yourself and the aggression that's actually happened to you. And sometimes it's hard to find the words or the courage or the energy. Sometimes you just don't have it in you to fight every single aggression, but you could still have the discussion with yourself to rectify what it's doing to you within your body. So if you are sitting with an uncomfortable experience, identify it and answer it. And the more we get used to being able to do that, I find that practice has made it easier for me to speak up for myself, because I've reinforced to my mind that what they're saying is not true. And eventually it gives me the courage to speak up. Okay, let's move to our next slide. Center the impacted. Now, yourselves as, right? And there's a lot of different ways that you can be an ally. And I also like to mention that today we are looking at this through an anti-Black racism lens, but we all have advantages within our own identities. And there's many different ways that we can be allies towards each other. So we are gonna talk now about what centering the impacted looked like. Let's go to our next slide. So let's say, in the face of racism, is speaking up something that you feel comfortable doing? Do you feel comfortable doing it with a peer? Do you feel comfortable doing it with a superior? Do you feel comfortable doing it with your family? I want to hear from you guys in the chat. If speaking up is something that you feel confident or comfortable doing. So before we, I do see some answers here, but I want to speak to a comment here about how does countering a positive message addressing the issues that need to be addressed? So I want to circle back around to this because it's important to note that both are important to do, right? That speaking to the person about the aggression is important too, but it's not always the easy thing to do, right? So if for some reason you cannot find the courage, or if for some reason it is not an easy situation to do it in, you can still use the technique of speaking to yourself. And even if you do speak up, you can still and should still use the technique of speaking to yourself, because something is happening within your body. But this is also just my opinion. So if it doesn't work for you, that's okay too.
I was also gonna add to that, Allison, just, mm-hmm. You know, we spent a lot of time with kind of sharing what somebody can do from their own perspective. But like you said, if you're comfortable in kind of, you know, reframing somebody's statement and letting them know at the same time why it needs to kind of just end at you're smart, right? Well, why do we need to add the context of race and gender and everything that's on the end of it? Why can't somebody just be smart? And maybe putting it to that perspective to say, well, smart is not only for, you know, a specific color, specific gender, because at the end they put Black girl, right? So I think it's maybe letting that person know too, just, you know, what comes off when you add that those two words at the very end, how it makes the statement so very different. And if that's if you're comfortable doing, and I think if you're not, Allison, exactly what you said with dealing with it internally is probably another alternative for many people, because that piece is not easy either, right? To be able to say that, especially when you guys all shared, I froze, I don't know what to do next. You might not know I'm ready to say something to that person in regards to their statement.
Okay. So what came of our question in the face of racism is speaking out something that we feel confident doing?
So we got a few. I'm cautious, yes, but I do. I feel comfortable around family and friends when the issue doesn't directly involve myself. I usually doubt myself and then kind of regret not speaking up after.
Okay, that's fair. Okay, let's move to our next slide. Now, we're going to look at privilege as if it's like a heavy boot, okay? I really like this example. Let me move this box out the way so I can read this properly. Okay, so imagine that your privilege is a heavy boot that keeps you from feeling when you're stepping on someone's feet or they're stepping on yours, while the oppressed people only have sandals. If someone says, ouch, you're stepping on my toes, how do you react? Now, this discussion is really important because we're talking about how to respond and how to respect the person that's being impacted by the aggression, right? Sometimes you're witnessing the person being impacted. So how can we show up for each other in the best way possible? Next slide, please. So there's different ways that people take in these comments, right? You can do it one way, you can center yourself, or you can center the impacted. So what does centering yourself look like? Okay, centering yourself could sound like, I can't believe that you think I'm a toe stepper. I'm a good person. Centering yourself can look like the denial of other people's experience that are different from your own by saying, I don't mind when people step on my toes. Derailing might sound like, some people don't even have toes. Why aren't we talking about them instead? Refusal to center the impacted might sound like, all toes matter. Next slide, please. Tone policing might sound like, I'd move my foot if you asked more nicely. Denial that the problem is fixable might sound like, toes getting stepped on is a fact of life. You'll just be better off when you accept that. Victim blaming might sound like, you shouldn't have been walking around people with boots. And withdrawing might sound like, I thought you wanted my help, but I guess not. I'll just go home. Next slide, please. Now, in reality, most of us naturally know the right way to react when someone steps on our toes. And we can use those same principles to help when we react to microaggressions by centering the impacted. Now, what is one way that you can do that? You can simply ask them, are you okay? And then listen attentively to their response, to listen and understand, but not to react. Sometimes we can ask questions. Well, not sometimes. I know I ask questions all the time and I already have the answer in my head and I'm waiting for you to tell me so that I can tell you. But that's like a large problem with how and why it's so difficult to have the discussion around racism, because we already have so many formed ideas in our mind of what the answers are going to be. And this is really something that's changing in front of our eyes, that we're getting a broader understanding in front of our eyes. So when we get the opportunity to hear from somebody who's impacted, it's really important for us to actually listen. The next way you can center the impacted is to apologize even if you didn't mean it by saying, I'm sorry. You can stop the instance by simply moving your foot, and you can stop the pattern by being careful where you step in the future. Can we go to our next slide? Okay, so here's something to consider. Do you think that you listen to people with an open mind? And you can let me know in the chat. Do you think you have a friend bring an experience with you? Am I back?
Yeah, you're back. You want to just repeat the question?
Yes. Do you listen with an open mind? If a friend is sharing an experience with you that perhaps you don't understand their perspective, do you listen with an open mind? Do you center the impacted? Do you try to consider their experiences? Before you conclude, have you heard from the underrepresented? What are we hearing in the chat, Jhanelle?
So we have a not always, one really good point that came up was it sometimes it's really hard to listen with an open mind when you have a lot that's going on yourself, like when you're stressed out. And I think one thing that comes up with that is really consider when you're asking somebody something, are you really intentionally asking? If you have enough on your plate, you really can't support what you're asking, then maybe it's not the best time to ask, right? Because now you're just getting somebody to put something on the table and you're not there to receive it.
Okay.
And then to summarize some of the last ones, the I can do better, I'm trying, really working on it and really taking the time right now, I think a lot to reflect and, like you said, be more intentional about being open-minded when speaking with others and listening to others.
Okay. And also keeping in mind, we are all learning. Right? We're all taking steps towards a better, safer place for us all to exist in. And we're not going to all do it right. So the intentionality behind doing it while we center the person who's being impacted is very important. And also understanding that if you get it wrong, apologizing and trying again is also an option. Let's go to our next slide. Okay, our last section here is activating our advantages. So how can we recognize what our privilege looks like and use it to activate and engage others? Let's go to our next slide. Okay, so something to consider. Jhanelle brought up this really good example of what riding a bike can teach us about privilege. Okay, so I want you to imagine for a second, and maybe a lot of you ride bikes. Does anybody ride a bike? Let me know in the chat if you guys got bikes. I got a bike this year because of quarantine. the prices of bikes have shot up. Okay, we got some bike riders, amazing. Now, imagine that you're now using a bike as your primary mode of transportation in a large city like Toronto or New York. By no stretch, this is not bike-friendly town. Okay, you have the right to be on the road, and the laws on the books make it acceptable. It doesn't change the fact that you are bike. In a world made for cars. Now, sometimes it's dangerous because people in cars can just blatantly be mean, right? Some people think it's funny to roll down their windows, to yell things, to splash water on you when they're driving by. These people are terrible. They're doing it on purpose, right? Those people are easy to identify. Some people are just annoyed with the mere presence of you being there on a bike, right? Now, I want you guys to list, I'm going to list some disadvantages of riding a bike. I want you guys to think about the advantages. Try to think about things like what? Potholes, broken glass, snow, piles of snow in the winter, trucks, fast cars, people not paying attention. Anybody else riding a bike? Not feeling so safe out there?
I think my favorite one is
we're using this as a
fly open, right? The bike lane.
Doors that fly open. Right? Now, some people are just straight inconsiderate. They're mean. They don't want you there. But there's so many other people who are using the road, who have cars, who don't even know that these things are happening to you or how dangerous it is, in fact, for you to be on a bike, on a road that you are legally allowed to be on, right? The problem with this is that the whole transportation infrastructure is built around cars, right? The laws, the culture, everything is around protecting, making more cars, creating more comfortable environments for cars. And this culture creates a mindset that makes you almost like a nuisance, right? So this is the problem with having the privilege of having a car. Towards cyclists, right? The things that in your car.
Oh, you're cutting out again.
You keep it going. Water on your car. Am I back?
Say something again.
How about now?
Yes.
Okay. Where did you last hear me?
You were wrapping up kind of the summary of it.
Okay. So the consequences of driving a car or the advantages of having a car are so much greater than that of, and if you never have to consider what a cyclist might have to experience, then you can just move through your life, right? And if even something happens where you get into a collision with a cyclist, or a cyclist gets into a collision, we have to consider that the consequences for them are so much greater. And that's the overall arching idea around privilege, right? That it's not, you didn't set up the road. It's not your fault that there's potholes or gravel or that it's so much more dangerous for a cyclist. But we're all living in a society where car drivers are getting so much more far ahead than cyclists, and things for cyclists are so much more dangerous just based on how the infrastructure of the road was built. Okay, let's go to our next slide. So we're gonna play a little game here. It's not a little game, but it's called acknowledging your privilege, right? So we're gonna list three descriptors of ourselves, right? You can use race, education, sex, gender, whatever you'd like, right? I am going to say that I am a Black, university educated, cisgendered woman. Okay. Jhanelle, would you like to list some of your descriptors? And you guys can put them in the chat. You can just write them down. List three descriptors.
I would say that I'm also a Black, I'm going to say female foodie is like I like to call it.
Okay, foodie. Perfect. Now, each of our descriptors carries advantages with it, right? So I want you to list three advantages that your descriptors affords you.
you guys can share it in the chat, that would be great.
That'd be awesome. Let's hear some of your descriptors and maybe just one advantage that that descriptor might afford you.
All right, so we have white, female, straight.
So some of the advantages that my descriptors might carry, and I think we can go to the next slide here. Perfect. Okay, so they don't have to be tremendously heavy. I'm gonna stay in black, so I've got this really cool afro. I'm going to say that I'm university educated, which means that I should have access to, you know, different types of jobs, higher education, higher pay rather. And as a cisgendered woman, I tend to experience less discrimination and things of that nature. Okay, are we getting any advantages in the chat?
Well, some other advantages that we have is being Middle Eastern light skin / white passing, black educated middle class. We have someone else who shared that, you know, I don't really experience any disadvantages based off of what they were listing or what they were thinking about. So I think the next piece of this will definitely help that. But yeah, English speaking was a really good one that came up as another advantage.
Okay. Very good. Okay, so our next step is we are going to debunk the scarcity mindset. Can we go to our next slide? So what we're going to do here is we're going to fill in this very thing. If you use any of your characters. So I'm going to say, if I use my advantage of higher pay to help someone, does it make me less of a Black, university educated, cisgendered woman? If you use your if I use my advantage of less discrimination because I'm cisgendered to help someone, does it make me less of a Black, university educated, cisgendered woman?
We're getting some no's, it does not.
Jhanelle, would you like? No, it does not. Okay, Jhanelle, do you want to fill in a sentence? And I'd love to hear from you guys what your sentences might look like.
Somebody asked if you were cutting out, if you could just explain again what they need to fill in.
Okay. So for sure. Okay, so in this exercise, we are debunking the scarcity mindset, right? So we have our descriptors and we have our advantages. So I want you to fill in the blanks. So for me, my sentence would sound something like, when I use my advantage of less discrimination as a cisgendered woman, does it make me less of a Black, university, cisgendered, educated woman? And I think Henry is pulling out something here that, and thank you. there is a misconception that when we share what we have less of it, right? That if we speak out or use our advantage, it will, you know, like decrease our place or our space. And that's why something like this is important, because when you use your advantages, and we can go to the next slide, when you use your advantages to help somebody else, it doesn't make you any less of who you are, right? Like you're still you. You still have access to all those amazing things. But the thing now here is now that we can use what we have to help each other, to kind of help even out the playing field so that everybody has access to these same advantages, right? So the fact, privilege does not decrease when it's shared. privilege is not decreased when it's shared. When you give generously with an abundance mentality, what you give multiplies. Okay, let's go to our next slide. Okay, there, here we are. Okay, so what are some basic benefits of allyship? New perspectives, new ideas, new outcomes. When we welcome each other with diverse backgrounds, we offer different perspectives, different talents, different skills and experience that benefits our society in so many different ways. We get the opportunity to create safe spaces, right? Everybody feels better when they feel safe, right? We have the opportunity to share. We have the opportunity to grow, right? When we create safe spaces. It just straight up discourages racism when you come forth as an ally, right? When people know that somebody is going to stand up for you, or you are going to stand up for yourself, or you're going to take the steps to call them out, they are less likely to do it, right? Because now they're confronted. And when we all stand up for each other and come forth for each other, it makes the person who is committing these acts a lot more uncomfortable, and it makes them just a lot more difficult for them to follow through on it. And it also gives us an opportunity to enhance our worldview by learning about other cultures and discovering new approaches to life. Okay, so we're back to the original question.
Oh, we lost you.
But not really. There we are.
There we go.
Back?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so we're back to our original question, and feel free to answer, not to answer. But based on this, would you consider yourself anti-racist? Let's go to our next slide. So here's our call to action. What mindful steps can you take towards becoming anti-racist? Is there someone who you can open yourself up to provide support? How can you activate your resources to grant opportunities to others? So we are at the 7 o'clock mark, but I would love to hear from you. If you consider yourself anti-racist, and if there is even a simple step that you can take towards that. And Jhanelle, I'd love to hear from you what's coming out in the conversation.
So I think a lot of what we have people saying that, you know, I'm going to work on this. I'm going to strive to try to use some of these calls to action. But there's also the question of how do I know when somebody is, you know, being racist around me for me to kind of activate this call of action. So that's one of the questions that came up. If you want to see how we can answer that while I keep looking at some of the other ones, because a lot of good context is coming.
Okay, so how do you know? That's a very good question, actually, because some of it's very subtle and not always as obvious, right? So I would say if that you are the person who is being impacted, if what you feel like happened towards you, if you feel comfortable, something's probably here. Now, it might not be on like a very large or obvious scale, but an indication in your body that this feels uncomfortable is enough. And maybe you might not have the words in that moment, but sit with it, review it, and come back to it later. If you witness it, I think it takes an act of noticing how it's impacting the person that's actually receiving the aggression, right? So you can do so by saying, are you okay? I felt uncomfortable in that situation, but I'm not exactly sure why, right? Or you can speak to somebody you trust. The University of Toronto has a whole department, which I mean, my school didn't have one, but you have a whole department around anti-racism, right? So there are people there like Jody who are in that space that can help you kind of decode maybe what you've experienced. Because sometimes it really takes a little bit of discussion to find out what's actually happening to us.
And then I think to add to that, so one of the ways is, how do I really detect that that's happening around me? Because I don't experience it. So how do I detect that it's happening in someone else? And I think a lot of it has to do with body language and just kind of the cues. Like, how does somebody walk away from that experience? Right? Did you witness that they looked uncomfortable? Did you witness that the things that we saw in the chat, like some people sharing, I froze, you know, I had to pause for a second. Did you witness that pause before a response? And then just repeating what was said sometimes can help too in detecting, is this something that might be a little bit uncomfortable for somebody else? If I repeat it, and I was like, well, if I had to put, you know, my context, like you were saying, if I replace being a Black girl with being a white male, how would I feel if somebody said something like that to me? So I think those are some ways to help detect it and help see if it's happening. And then the best thing of all is, if you have that relationship that you notice it, ask, right? If you have that, if you're comfortable with that person, or if you see, you know, they walked off a little bit uncomfortable, ask them, you know, how, are you okay? You look like, and then you can find out, like, was that something that you would have to be mindful of next time?
And also just sharing that, I'm not really sure. I'm not really sure what I experienced. I'm not really sure how to proceed here, but I want to support you in this. Is there a way I can support you in this? And then leaving it open to hear what that response is. Okay. Is there anything else coming up in our discussion?
All right, now everybody's saying good suggestion. Thank you so much for the space and the conversation and dialogue.
Perfect. Let's go to our next slide. And then we're going to let Jody slide on in here. Growth and comfort do not coexist. And I really do appreciate everybody coming within It's uncomfortable to experience, it's uncomfortable to do, especially when you want to move towards the right thing. We are all trying to figure this out, right? So if it feels uncomfortable, that's okay, because growth and comfort, they don't exist. Let's go to our next slide. So this is what's coming up next. On November 17th, we're holding a movement-based class, so movement and meditation for Black students only. And on the 18th, we are holding the same sort of movement class for all racialized students. And we're gonna invite Jody back into the conversation to wrap it up for us.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you once again, Jhanelle, Allison, for holding space and guiding the space with some intentional dialogue on allyship to all of you who were able to join. Thank you so very much for contributing and for allowing ourselves to deepen our knowledge, understanding, and action planning on what it means to engage in mindful allyship. Next slide, please, Natasha. And so in addition to the sessions very specific to Restore that were just shared, also wanting to share the Office's speaker series. Our next event is coming up as well on November 25th. So quite a busy and active November with some key sessions that we're inviting all folks to come in and partake in. And on November 25th, we'll be having a keynote presentation looking at addressing anti-Asian racism and xenophobia and the implications for post-secondary environments. It's open to everyone, including external communities. So feel free to share and register if need be. And you will be receiving at some point an evaluation form. It may either be placed in the link or you may receive it by email. Just going to ask you if you could kindly complete the evaluation as this is our first time running this program. We're very much excited to receive your feedback. Jhanelle, Allison, as always, you know how I feel about your sessions. Thank you once again for holding space to all of you here. Have a fantastic evening. To the ArcDo team, thank you once again for all of your hard work and have a good evening, everyone. Everybody take care. Allison and Jhanelle, maybe we'll debrief at another time, just given the hour. All right.
No problem. Good.
All right. And have a great evening,
everyone. Good night, everyone. Thank you for coming. I hope to see you again.
Bye.
Bye-bye.